We were talking about levitation earlier, and I was telling you how I heard that there was someone on a British TV show. I think it might have been something like Britain's Got Talent, that kind of show, and this person was showing their talent that they could levitate. And I found that really quite concerning, because I thought, you've got young people watching this, people across Britain watching and thinking this is a party act, something cool to learn, and they might go out and try learning this, and it's just really quite sad because they don't realise the powers involved are not just power of the mind, or it's actually demonic powers. And you told me about a woman, you visited her house and she was levitating.
Yes.
And you said to her, come down in Jesus' name, and she came down. That in itself emphasises the powers used are demonic if they submit in Jesus' name.
Barry Smith, the famous New Zealand evangelist, he used to spend a lot of time in the Polynesian islands, Fiji and Tonga and places like that. Barry Smith used to see this all the time. He said he used to go to villages where people, were thirsty to hear the word of God. And he said that there used to be a shaman or a witch doctor or a leader of those people. And he said very often he used to see people levitating. When he went in to give them the word of God, people levitating. And he would always call them down in Jesus' name. George Harrison spoke about when he first went to India to study under the Maharishi Yogi in those Beatles years, the transcendental meditation years. And he said he witnessed people in caves levitating. The woman I saw levitating was levitating because she needed deliverance, and she'd been seriously sexually abused as a young child, and that was the cause of her levitating. Levitation is almost like your body is being totally taken over by an energy and a force. And why would you want to levitate? I'm going to see a woman very shortly who has levitation problems.
Yeah.
You know, at certain religious times in the year, she levitates. She's been involved with other religions and other faiths. So levitation is something that Jesus never spoke about levitating. He never said it was a gift of the Spirit. He never said it was something we could attain by serving him. A lot of people misuse the scripture when he walked on water. But when Jesus walked on water, he was showing he was the Lord over all, and he had total dominion over the wind and the waves. So levitation is a creepy thing. In Britain's Got Talent and various other things, we all know the power of illusion. Now, I'm a number one fan of magicians. I love watching people like David Copperfield. I used to love Siegfried and Roy, who used to make lions and tigers disappear. I've read books about Harry Houdini. But these people who were illusionists, they use cameras and trick mirrors and trick photography. That's part of entertainment. When people claim to levitate for some sort of spiritual understanding, or claim to have out-of-body experiences, I think that they lose control of their bodies and they don't know what's taken them over. Mm-hmm. But if anyone is watching this program who knows people who levitate, tell them to come down in Jesus' name and to stay there. Mm-hmm. We have the authority to do so.
Yeah. Amen. Going back to deliverance again.
Yes.
Do you find that sometimes when people contact you for deliverance ministry, they sometimes feel all the responsibility for their freedom is on you, the minister? Because I've certainly found this, and often, probably just because there's a lack of teaching in the church, but often I have to try and emphasise, firstly, before you seek deliverance, build yourself up in your faith. The importance of scripture, the importance of really learning fully their identity in Christ, their own authority in Christ, and things like death to self, denying certain sins that may have led to the demonization, denying that sin repeatedly, overcoming with Christ's help before they then come for deliverance. Do you find if they do that, their deliverance is then easier?
Well, people have free will. It's an abuse of free will that leads them in these situations to start with. though they may not think that at the time, they have been seduced and tempted to adapt a certain lifestyle to themselves. But always remember that Jesus is the deliverer, that no deliverance minister can deliver. He doesn't have that power and authority. He moves in Jesus' power and authority. If people don't wish to be delivered, people have to understand that deliverance is about giving things up. If someone has demons and evil spirits and they come from fornication or certain sexual practices, you know, you can't then ask someone to deliver you and then go back into those practices again. Yeah. You have to be willing to slay those things that are in your life that have caused you problems. Mm-hmm. Many people, I prayed for a guy recently who had many, many problems, and he was quite delusional. He was quite delusional. Almost saw himself as a warrior of God, specially selected to serve God and be God's champion. But he certainly had demonic problems, and I believe these problems came from these grandiose feelings he had about himself. And he really wouldn't listen. He really wouldn't listen at all. God has told me, I know what I'm doing. I know what I'm called to do. So, you know, I had to say to this guy, I'm sorry, I don't think I can help you. Because he wasn't willing to come under subjection to the Holy Spirit. Yeah. And we have to be willing to come under subjection to the Holy Spirit. And, you know, a common thing that really is a bit of a bugbear to me is I go to many, many houses and I'm welcomed. And I go in and people tell me about their problems. They will say to me, have you got children? And I will say, yes, I've got 4 children. And many of us in ministry have this sadness of having children who are not born again. Children are not walking with the Lord. And some, in cases, as in mine, some children are estranged from us because they decide that there's something wrong with us because we don't agree to their lifestyle, so they separate themselves from them. I've got children who say that. And you can sit in people's homes. I had one recently, and a lady said that none of her children were born again. They believed Jesus was a fairy tale, and they actually bring their children up to be opposed to the Christian message. And I listened, I didn't say anything, and the lady turned around and said that one of her children was involved in earning his living as a tattooist. And as soon as you actually say, oh, well, the Bible speaks against this, and you show them the scripture, and these are people's children who they love, they adore, you find these people take issue with you because you've said something they don't like. And over the years, I would like a pound for all the times I've said something that people don't like about their lifestyles, about certain things. And, you know, I went to a lady once who had quite a lot of authority for the local council. She actually had authority to go into homes where she thought children wasn't being looked after properly, and she could remove those children from that home. She actually contacted me with a deliverance problem. And her deliverance problem was she had sexual problems. She was very promiscuous. And we sat there, myself and Janice, my wife, sat there and spoke to us, and she didn't like it at all. And we said these problems would not stop until she came to terms with what she was doing. It wasn't only that she was promiscuous, it was some of the things she practiced within that promiscuity. And she opened the door and chucked us out. And she said, you don't understand, all I want to be is a born-again Christian, free of demons, and continue to have an active sex life. And we said, well, I'm sorry, if you want to serve Jesus, you've got to have the lifestyle that allows you to serve Jesus. And she couldn't wait to get us out of the house. So sometimes you're going to say things in deliverance that people are not going to like.
Yeah.
But the Bible says that the truth shall set you free.
Well, that's it. If people need help, sometimes they need to hear the truth and accept it and be humble in receiving teaching that's going to help them.
You can't go into a pub if you've got an alcohol problem. Mm. Sit in the middle of a pub with an orange juice and say, right, oh God, I'm here, deliver me. It doesn't work like that.
Yeah.
You have to take yourself out of these places that are going to cause you problems. And whether that's sex, whether it's the occult, whether it's something simple as bingo or gambling or things like that, you've really got to do the work that you need to do. It's not all about Jesus. Greatest scripture is the woman with the issue of blood. She had been to the doctors, she had been to the practitioners at the time, and no one, they had obviously given her potions and various things, and no one could heal her. She got through the crowd on her hands and knees and clasped the hem of Jesus' garment. Jesus never healed her. Jesus saw the virtue or the power go out of him.
He felt it go out of him.
And he turned around and said, "Daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith has made thee whole." She realized that the only way she could be healed was approaching Jesus. Because of her issue of blood, she would have been ritually unclean. She wouldn't have been able to approach Jesus normally. So she had to go through on her hands and her knees and clasp the hem of his garment, the lowest part she could clasp. But because she had faith and she wanted change, she was healed. And anyone who's seeking deliverance, they have to change. The things that have caused them the problems have to be eradicated from their life. And no deliverance minister can cast out a demon from someone unwilling to change.
Do you find as well that oftentimes people don't always realise all that's involved, and they feel you can just say a prayer and they'll be set free?
Yes.
But you have to sometimes encourage them to list certain sins, repent of those sins, turn away from it, and also pre-deliverance advice, if you like, where you have to advise folks to cleanse their house of certain objects, because you told me sometimes you go to people's homes and you notice things about their house that is part of their problem, but once they break that stuff and throw it out, their deliverance comes easier.
It's very, very common that people want deliverance, and you may look at their book shelf and they may have books for the occult there. You know, and I mean, I've been in many houses and I've said, "I'm sorry, but that object has to go," or whatever, and people have balked and said, "But it cost money, it was worth," you know. And I said, "Well, nothing's that expensive. If it denies you the right to the kingdom of God, then surely any price is worth paying." Jesus put it, you know, "Why inherit the whole world yet forfeit your soul?" So you've got to be willing to pay the price. And you've got to be willing to get rid of these things out of your house. And I would always say to people, I went to a house once to somebody who had HIV. And her mother said, "Can't you just pray?" And she gave me the names of various high-profile deliverance ministers, who none of them would help this girl. None of them would actually help her. And I said, "Well, do you know which person infected you with the HIV? And she said, "No." She said, "I've had 6 sexual partners." I said, "So it could have been the first one infected you, and you've infected the other 5. So what we need to do, we need to list the names of the 6 sexual partners. We have to forgive them, all of them, and we have to forgive you in case you failed them." Of course, she looked at me, and she was unwilling to really go ahead with this under those circumstances. She just thought that I could bind, curse, and cast out this spirit of infirmity that had given her the HIV. And I said, "No, it has to be done this way." And her mother, who went to a large Pentecostal church, very atmospheric and very, you know, I think the modern word is super spiritual, very super spiritual. She thought I didn't know what I was talking about. And I said to her, "Well, okay, I'll leave you." And I left them and went away. And she didn't get the help she needed. And she came back, and eventually she succumbed to the way it had to be done. And we brought into question the time she had been to a fortune teller. But she said, "There's nothing wrong in that." And I said, "Well, if Jesus is your future, why would you want to know your future from a lady in a house who charged you £30 for a palm reading? Why would you want to know that?" And it was a battle with her, a battle with her. And she developed lymph gland cancer as a secondary disease before she got deliverance. And I went to St. Bartholomew's Hospital one Wednesday afternoon to visit her. And it was only that time when I went in there that she really came to terms with her life, the sins of her life, and she gave her life to the Lord. And this woman got healed and she got delivered after she came to terms with it.
Mm-hmm.
You see, we have to clear the decks, mm-hmm. and we have to go to the Lord naked. Mm-hmm. We have to stand before Him, warts and lumps and bumps, and we say, "Here I am, Lord. I have no power and authority over this situation. You do. So I totally surrender to you physically, emotionally, and spiritually." Only if you do that will you get completely delivered and healed. This woman was. She was completely delivered and healed.
Amen. That's wonderful.
You know, and only when she did that. But I had a terrible battle getting her there.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because her mother in particular was relying on a super name from the Christian world.
Mm-hmm.
He will come and cast this disease from my daughter. He will come. But he never did.
Mm-hmm.
He never did.
That's wonderful. She got healed and
she
delivered.
Did get healed and delivered. Yeah. Unfortunately, the story then goes that she went back to the church who didn't offer her any help. And unfortunately, they exploited her. They made videos about her healing, claiming it happened in the church, which it didn't. But that wasn't for me to question. I didn't complain or say anything.
Mm.
It's God who is the
healer.
God knows the truth, so you just leave it.
Mm-hmm.
You do get some disappointments in the deliverance ministry sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
You do get that. People come to you for help because they don't feel they can get help in their church. Or maybe they feel a bit self-conscious of approaching pastors in their church, so they go outside. And of course, I've had people delivered. Funny story, this is a true story, and I found out this recently. I went to see somebody, and I was praying for them. And the lady said, "Do you remember about 12 years ago, you prayed for a lady who was barren and didn't have a child?" And I said, "Did I?" And she said, "Oh, yes." And she gave me the lady's name. And I said, "Oh, I do remember praying for someone." And they said, "Well, what happened? You moved." I said, "Did I?" She said, "Just after you prayed for her, you moved house, you had a different phone number and everything else." Right, she said, "That woman had a baby, she fell pregnant." She said, "The baby's 11 now, the child's 11. And I found out about it all those years after. So God is good, He knows. I don't particularly have to know.
Yeah.
If someone is set free, no deliverance minister should seek fame, fortune or gratitude. You're a servant of the Lord. And it's good enough that someone's set free from demons and evil spirits or they're healed. Because providing you can go to heaven and you can get welcomed in as a faithful servant, then that's what it's all about."
Exactly, and all the glory goes to God.
All the glory should go to God.
Goes to Him all the time. Mike, have you got any closing comments you would like to say just in conclusion?
I believe deliverance is available for everyone. And what I would say, deliverance is not about people growling and roaring, rolling over the floor, making strange gurgling sounds, or somebody standing over you with a large black coat on, doing mortal battle to the death with the devil. When this is portrayed in certain horror films and you see the exorcist standing there with crucifixes and throwing holy water about, deliverance is not like that. Sometimes there has to be an element of casting out in deliverance, but deliverance is about examining your life, examining things that have gone wrong in your life, and through prayer and an anointing of the Holy Spirit, bringing the healing that's necessary to bring restoration. Deliverance is all about restoration.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's and a lot of the time it gets bad press, because there is a lot of bad deliverance around.
Yeah.
There is a lot of bad deliverance around. People who are very poorly trained, who believe they have a calling to cast demons out. I have to say, and this may sound controversial, if you read the last chapter of the Gospel of Mark, he said, "Go ye into the world and preach the good news to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized shall be saved. Whoever isn't shall be condemned. In my name you shall speak in new tongues. You shall cast out devils." Any born-again Christian who has accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Saviour can cast out demons.
Amen. Yep.
They can do it. They have that authority to do it.
Yeah.
Jesus has given us that authority in that Great Commission. To actually examine people's lives and bring in the restoration they need to get them set free of various problems in their life takes a lot of training.
Mm-hmm.
And you just can't cast out devils. If you cast out a devil and you don't bring in the necessary safe guards there after the demon has left, then he will come back.
Yeah, scripture says that, doesn't it?
Yeah, and sometimes the person is in a worse state because the Bible speaks about it getting seven more demons, even more wicked than itself, and coming back. So that's what deliverance is. Deliverance is cleansing. I wish people in mental health authorities and things like that would embrace deliverance, embrace the science of deliverance, because it is a science. And, you know, I believe that many people could visit those who are classed as insane, and maybe some of these people can be restored.
Yeah. I've saw that happen myself. People that were diagnosed with certain mental illnesses were set free when they had deliverance.
Dr. Anna Mendes-Farrell, who's written various great books, one of them's Regions of Captivity, she herself was in a psychiatric hospital. And when she became born again, her and the pastor went throughout that psychiatric hospital, and 70% of all the people they prayed for then got released.
That's awesome, isn't it?
Yeah.
Praise God. That's wonderful.
Yes.
It's very encouraging. Yeah.
So there is a lot to be said for deliverance, providing it's applied right, and it's applied with the right heart, and you were just wishing to set the captives free. We must go back to Isaiah 61, which also became Luke 4. It says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, for he has anointed me. And he speaks about setting the captives free, opening the prisons for those who are bound. And, you know, what demons try and do is bind you and ruin your life. And, you know, deliverance through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour, sets the captives free.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I would just like to finish by saying you have a new website, and if people want to find out where you're going to be preaching or if you've got any deliverance events in England, they could look at the website from time to time and find out. So the website is christsetsyoufree.wordpress.com. That's christsetsyoufree.wordpress.com. And please look at that from time to time and find out what Michael's doing, and you can even arrange to go to some of his meetings and seek ministry if you feel led to do that. So thank you so much, Michael, for coming all the way from London to sunny Glasgow today. It was lovely to see you, and thank you so much for the interview.
Thank you for interviewing me, and bless you.
Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you.
God bless you.